Today's curiosity is aided by Juice of the Oats Oatmeal Stout, a product of Oxus Brewing in Winnipeg. They call it an easy drinking dark ale with the aromas of coffee and chocolate. Today I'm going to be taking a closer look at this power supply that I got in the last mailbag. If you saw that video, you may recall that this is a 200 watt 12 volt DC power supply. It claims to work off an input voltage between 180 and 240 volts, 50 or 60 hertz. DC output 12 volts at up to 16.67 amps. If you're watching that mailbag, you also will remember that I tested this thing. It does in fact work at 120 volt line voltage here in North America. So I didn't waste my, what did I pay for this thing? $9, I think, which is an incredibly cheap price for something like this if it does the job. And that if it does the job is exactly what I'm going to test today. Not sure if you can see the details of the construction here, but basically there is a lower shell and then an upper cover that's clipped on. I think I can just squeeze that, and I might need a spudger. Squeeze that in and get a spudger under it, and yeah, the cover just pops off. Great for accessibility. Maybe not so good for protection if it's installed in the wild, although you'd want to install this someplace inaccessible to the public, so maybe that's not a horrible thing. Anyway, let's do a quick look through here. We have ground, neutral, and live for the AC input, a position where there could be a fuse, except for there isn't. Ground screw, which is actually connected to the back of the case, so that's good. Or at least it's good if the electrical ground actually connects to that. It is. Okay, so that's good. We have a good ground connection all the way along. Yay! Following along just from what we can see after the non-existent fuse, we have a bridge rectifier. We have an NTC, which I assume is acting as a self-resetting kind of a fuse. So it will only warm up when there's too much current, and it warming up will mean it's resistance goes high, limit the current, and make things happier. Then we have a big capacitor here, which presumably is smoothing that DC. We have a smaller capacitor. We have a fairly high wattage resistor there. Capacitor, another diode there. We have Q1. What Q1 is doing. Q is usually a transistor of some sort. And we have what appears to be a transformer. Well, it is a transformer, but it might be being used as an inductor, or it's more likely being used as a step down. Then we have a big honking diode there in a TO3 package. That's not TO3, that's a TO220 package. Then we have a couple of capacitors and the output. Won't miss this. We have a class Y capacitor there. Okay. And a little LED by the output that I didn't notice before. Oh, and then down by the transformer, we have what looks like an opto-isolator with a little anti-tracking slot beside it. Maybe? Question mark? I suppose the prudent thing to do would be to take it out of its case and just see what's on the backside of this board. So it looks like there's only three screws holding the board in, that grounding screw being one of them, and then the other two being the two screws that are holding down these two TO220 packages. Looks like those had some good clamping force because it's bent the aluminum around there. Anyway, that's all that's holding it in except for a bit of heat sink goop, which wasn't all that adhesive. Oh, okay, we've got a bunch more components on the backside here. So again, starting down near the input, there's the bridge rectifier there. There's this big honking smoothing capacitor. They've got some extra solder on top of some of these traces just for a little bit more current handling. Some resistors. U1, which is a 6-pin device, so that is likely going to be the switch mode power supply device. Ah, okay, so then that will be driving this transistor here, Q1, which I now expect should be a MOSFET, and that will be chopping up the high DC voltage to send it through the transformer. And there's the transformer there. Pretty good blank space underneath the transformer. That's not bad spacing. Well, that's the class Y capacitor, so you're not going to get any further apart there because that's just the size of the capacitor. However, over here we have a whole bunch of small components, capacitors, resistors. What are you? U2? It's transistor? Well, Q2 probably. So that pretty much destroys our separation between the primary and secondary side. Not super impressed with that.
Though I guess that slot does create some extra separation.
Anyway, over here on the secondary side, we have some fairly big pads or tracks with extra solder on top of them for extra current handling. So that's cool. Some more resistors, capacitors, etc., etc. There is the big diode that's actually rectifying the high frequency on the secondary side. Those are a bunch of 1K resistors that appear to be in parallel and appear to be across the capacitors and across the output. So I guess load resistors to bring these two capacitors back down to nothing when it shuts off and do it fairly quickly. Fairly standard switch mode power supply, really. Nothing too extreme going on here. I'd like to see more separation underneath that transformer from the low voltage to the high voltage side. I would have liked to seen that fuse there. Although I guess this is the two pads that are marked fuse on the other side. And I guess the track does neck down a little bit, so that could act as a fuse, I suppose. And then there is this little NTC thermistor self-resetting fuse kind of dude sitting here too in series. So that's something, I guess. Not the best protection that I've ever seen, but I've also seen a lot worse from cheap Chinese devices. Oh, and the other thing on this side, there's where the two heatsink pads are. They both got some goop on them, this guy a bit more than this guy. But there is also a plastic sheet in here to keep the back side of the circuit board from coming in contact with the aluminum. So they've gone that far, at least, in the way of safety. I'm just going to put this guy back in again. And I guess I'll use the ground screw over here to line it up. And then I'll clamp back down those two devices, the transistor, MOSFET, and the diode over here. And then we'll get to testing this thing and see if it can actually live up to its claims. That's not the worst hold down method I've seen. It's pretty low budget, but I guess it does the job. Anyway, let's get some power on this thing and see if it lives up to its billing. So for a load, I've put together a couple of 25 watt 8 ohm resistors in parallel, giving me a 4 ohm load, and with 12 volts going into it, that should be about a 3 amp load, which is well under what this thing is capable of, but for now I just want to give it, you know, a certain amount of load, which is going to be 36 watts. Even though you're 25 watts, it's spread across the two of them. I've got them bolted onto a heat sink, and I do have some heat sink material underneath them, so hopefully they won't get too hot and destroy anything. But yeah, that's my test rig. And then just for fun, I'll plug it in through this meter here, this kilowatt style meter. It says it's drawing about 620 milliamps AC. AKA 3 watts. And as I saw in the mailbag when we were testing it, it is pretty much bang on 12 volts output, even with that load on it. So that's good to see. Next test, I think I'm going to adjust the input voltage a little bit, for which we'll need the auto transformer. And the problem with this is you can't see the input voltage. Another meter. That across there. Turn that on. So 135 volts coming out here right now. And that's basically the same. This thing claims to work up to 240 volts, so 135 shouldn't be a big deal. But let's just see what happens when we start cranking down the input voltage. That's 99 volts, and we're still nice and stable over there. 78 volts. Yeah. Let's keep going down until it loses its mind here. Oh, seeing a little bit of movement there. There we go. Let's bring it back up until it's working. That is 50 volts AC input. Wow. And then, of course, if we crank this all the way to max, that's 143 volts. No surprise there. So when that shuts off, because of the resistors across that plus the load, that should drop to zero almost immediately, and it does. You know what I didn't see, though? I didn't see any discharge resistor across that capacitor. Now look at that. It's like 13 volts across that capacitor, and it is shut off. Obviously, when the thing's running, there should be a lot more voltage on there. So yeah, that makes sense. 125 volts, full bridge rectified, and then capacitor to smooth it out. That's about right. Let's see what happens when I shut that off. It drops down to 10 volts almost immediately, and then it's climbing back up slowly, even though there's no input. Does any of that back feed through the bridge rectifier? It shouldn't. No, it doesn't. Okay. So the input is still safe, but there's still just that lingering voltage in there. Huh. I wonder how long it takes to go away. We might as well go one step further and test this at higher voltages. Here I've got a 120 to 220 volt transformer. It's only good for 50 watts, but that's something. I'm not going to push it any harder. Well, too much harder anyway. Yeah, I do have a higher load on it. Whatever, we'll go with it for now. Just set that to 233, 214, 216, 219, close enough. Put in a wee death adapter and plug that in. No explosions. 12 volts there. Cool. It does the job. I don't know. What other tests can I do? Maybe I can check the output voltage on the scope. See how smooth it is. Sure. Let's do that. This is a little bit difficult to see because the scope tube is old and dim. But it looks like the switching frequency on this thing, the chopping frequency, is about 67-ish kilohertz, thereabouts. And if I flip the voltage here and just try and find my cursors wherever they are, there's one, where's the other one? Looks like we're about 40 millivolts or thereabouts. Now that's been running for a little while, let's just see what we got for hot spots in here. What is that? Well, that's my loads. So my load is about 150 degrees Celsius. Wow. But on the unit itself, the hotspot seems to be down here at about 78, which I believe is the NTC. Yes, it is the NTC. What's the bridge rectifier? Is at about 58 or thereabouts? 60, and the NTC is running at about 80 some. Okay. What else we got up in this direction here? Nothing else is running. Well, 4950, where are you? That's the transformer. That's the diode there, the double diode that's the hottest there, and that's at about 47. And it should be heat sinking onto the back here. Yes, it is. I can feel it, but it's not too bad. This MOSFET's staying relatively cool. I can just barely feel it's just slightly above ambient. So that's not too bad. The NTC is going to be current limiting the whole thing at this end, which is its entire job. So I guess that's providing some protection. And yeah, the hottest things in my setup are in fact my load resistors. Oof, and I can feel them. Even those heat sinks are getting hot. Wow. Time to unplug that. That's good, I guess, that my test loads are getting hotter than any other part of the circuit. Oh, that's not too bad. I'm fairly happy with that, all told. Especially for as cheap as it was. I mean, there are things that it could do better. Like I said, there could be a discharge resistor on that cap. That would be nice. There could be a fuse over there where it's got one marked, but there is sort of a fusible track on there, so I guess that's okay. The isolation here is mostly okay, except for all these little surface mount resistors and stuff on the back side of the board, which are completely destroying what otherwise looks like good separation. Looks like they tried, but I don't know. What do you think? I'm willing to use this for LED strips indoors, in a well-ventilated area, not mounted onto, you know, wood or something completely flammable. And I'm never going to be running, you know, what's the maximum of this thing? 16 amps? No way. There's no way I'm going to run that much out of it. But even with, you know, 3.5 or 3.6 amps worth of load, it seems to do the job. And I doubt I'm going to get that many LEDs running off it at any time. So I think it's a win, especially for the price. Of course, you guys can comment down below if you have other opinions. As always, thanks for watching. I will talk to you later.